that we know that you don't want, that you want us to let go of, and we come with that, and we just come back to your arms that you may heal us, and that you may revive us, and that you may just give us a filling of your Spirit, of your Holy Spirit, that we may know what it is that you want us to do. We pray, O Jesus, that you would speak to us, that you would minister to us, and that you would humble our hearts before you, that we would seek you, and we pray that you would give us understanding, and that you would empower us and revive us by your Holy Spirit. Pray for anointing on the words spoken as you've spoken to us through the songs and prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Last week we studied verses 6 and 7. Tonight we will be starting with verse 8. So just to review, let's help me out. Let's try to, this way if someone missed, they would kind of know. So verse 6, and now you know what is restraining. So who did we say that was? The Holy Spirit, right? So here we're talking the time of the tribulation, end times, and we've seen, just maybe as a quick review to kind of get perspective, verse 3, let no one deceive you by any means, for that day, meaning the day of the Lord, which is the day of Christ, which is the time of the tribulation, that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, meaning people are going to reject Christianity and the knowledge of God completely. So it's not like not being cool Christian today. It's very different. It's just you're not allowed at all. And then, and the man of sin is revealed. That's the Antichrist, the son of perdition. His end is he's going to perish, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God. So anyone that calls himself God, he says, I oppose you and I'm higher than you. And then, or that is worshipped, if you worship anything, I am opposing you, I stand against you, you're not allowed to do that, so that he sits as God. So he says, by the way, I'm going to sit here and I'm going to be as God in the temple of God, so that this tells us that the temple of Israel is going to have to come up again, in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. And he is saying, by the way, I am God, so I want you to worship me. And that's exactly what Antichrist is. He opposes Christ, but he also wants to be the worshipped one. And then, do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? So here he says, by the way, you know, this is not new news to you guys. I told you this stuff. And now, you know what is restraining. So he says, but I still want you to know that right now, the rapture hasn't happened yet. In order for this time period to happen, the tribulation, there has to be the rapture that happens first. The rapture, you can't time. It is instantaneous. And then the time of the tribulation is a time that you can actually, there's quite documentation of the time period of what happens when. So he says, listen, that, and now you know what is restraining. You are before the rapture. Nothing can happen. There's someone still in control. Even if it looks like a lawless world, there's still someone in control, and that is the Holy Spirit. And he's restraining that he may be revealed in his own time. So this Antichrist wants to come out, wants to be revealed, but he can't. And the one who's in control of the timing of when he comes out is actually the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is the one who's restraining him, and he can't do anything about it. And then he says, for the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. So lawlessness is already working, but he calls it mystery of lawlessness because no matter how evil and how lawless this world is, it is under the table. It is doing it in secret. It can't be at its full power because God is restraining. God is in control. And we talked a little bit about the power of the Holy Spirit in the world and the power of the Holy Spirit in us. And we took an example, the worst believer, Lot, that even he was powerful enough that God could not destroy Sodom and Gomorrah until he got him right out of there. So can you imagine us? And we know the truth of the Word of God. And then he says, of lawlessness is already at work. Only he, about the Holy Spirit, who now restrains, will do so until he is taken out of the way. And then the Holy Spirit, his dwelling, his home right now, is here in us. Then he's going to be taken out of the way, and then it is on. And this is going to happen at the time of the rapture. So this comes to our verse for tonight, verse 8. So here we see after the Holy Spirit is taken out of the way, and then, right at that exact time, the lawless one will be revealed. Why? Because there's no more restraining. He can just come out, and show himself for who he really is. And then it says, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. So he says, oh, by the way, I want you to know the end of the story, the end of the game. So this way, when you watch the game, it's not, you're not getting surprised and getting very, messing with your emotions. Now, I don't know about you guys, but if you ever had one of those things where you're watching a game, let's talk sports, and this particular game, someone else watched it, and you're like, okay, I just want to like watch it, and you didn't get to watch it live. So, and you're not going to look on any, like, you know, any YouTube or any social media, because you don't want anyone to ruin for you what's going to happen. You want to watch this game from start to finish. And then somebody comes and just ruins your day. They come and tell you the result, not asked for, not solicited, and in whatever form, right? They're like, you know, whatever the sport is, whatever the team is, you know, this one won. You're like, come on, now you don't even want to watch it anymore. Or, you know, they say they text you, or they send you a Facebook thing, or you're trying to avoid whatever method. They come after, they call you, like, oh, by the way, guess what? And they tell you. So it kind of ruins it. It doesn't make it that much fun to watch. Well, the Lord says, I'm going to ruin it. This one is really important for me to ruin it and take the fun out of it, because it's scary. So he says, listen, before you get all worked up about this lawless one and how scary and how... He's scary. We're going to talk about how scary he is tonight. He is really scary, this lawless one. And before you get all worked up about how scary and how difficult he is, I want you to not be afraid. Because I want you to know his end result. I want you to watch the match, all of it. So I'm going to give you the beginning. He's going to be revealed. We've already, he told us, he pumped us up about him, right? That he, the guy is a lunatic. He's crazy. He comes out and he says, I am God. I mean, if someone claims that today, people would laugh at them like, really? Ha ha, that's hilarious. The atheists would this would be like their joke on social media. Like, yeah, okay. That day, the atheists, there's not going to be atheists. They're going to think that that guy is God. For real, they're going to really believe and worship this crazy man. And so here we see that he's leading up to this really crazy guy. And then so he says, listen, he's going to be revealed. The Holy Spirit is out. The rapture has happened. Now he's going to be revealed. And there's going to be a seven-year period. So I'm going to give you the beginning. He's going to be revealed. And then I want to tell you at the end what's going to happen to him. Here's what's going to happen to him. And here he says that, and then the lawless one will be revealed, comma. So there's time frame, seven years, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth. So when the Lord comes, he's going to destroy him. This guy stands no chance against the power of the Lord. He's going to consume him by the breath of his mouth. So there's power in the Lord's mouth. And destroy with the brightness of his coming. And then he's going to actually come physically. And his coming is going to be so bright, he's going to destroy him and get rid of him. So can you imagine if we know, by the way, we're not going to be here. Or if you're a believer, you're not going to be here. If you're not a believer and the rapture happens today, good luck. We talked about what's going to happen to you. Because if there's no Jews here, if you're a Gentile, and if you happen to believe, you're going to die. Okay? Revelation chapter 7, we talked about it last week. But if you're a Jew and you're the 144,000, you'll survive. So here we see that that he says, I'm going to end this guy. So let's take that part. Last week, we studied a little bit in Revelation 7. So I'd like to go to a couple of chapters in Revelation, but one right now and one a little later. Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19. Verse 11. Now I saw heaven opened. So here, he looks up, or he's looking, and then heaven, you know, here's heaven, and then it opens. Okay, well, now we need to know what's coming out of heaven. So I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. So there's a horse, it's a white horse, and this is a war horse, a horse that is there to fight war. So there's a white horse, and he who sat on it was called faithful and true. You guys know who's the one sitting on this white horse? Antichrist. So is the Antichrist coming from heaven? Jesus, right? Jesus. So But you're right. So in Revelation 6, the Antichrist comes sitting on a white horse. So it's confusing. That's why I wanted to differentiate. How do we know the difference? This one is coming, right? Oh, heaven is open, and the Antichrist is coming out of there. How do we know that it can't be the Antichrist? Because Satan was kicked out of heaven. So the realm of heaven, there was war between Michael and the angels, and then Satan and his demons, and they went at it. And it was intense, but then we know who won that war. The war of the heaven. Because right now, can Satan go to heaven or no? I see this. So now I'm confused. Which one is it? And prove yourself. Don't just tell me I say so. Oh, my goodness. Okay, see? See, my wife just, you know, superseded all the raised hands. Hey, man, you're like the Lord here. He just killed their... So you're right. So what happened? In Job, that's still no rapture, right? I hope we believe that one, okay? There's no controversy on that one. So in Job, Satan went up where? To heaven. God, the Lord, was having a meeting in heaven with the angels, and then this guy just pops in there. So Satan can go to heaven now. Even today, he could still go to heaven. But there's a time, not yet, this is in the tribulation, where Satan's going to go, have war, and then the angels are going to defeat them. And then Satan's going to be kicked out, down to earth, no more allowed to go on higher levels, no longer allowed to go to heaven, and he's going to say, oh, my time is short, and he's going to come down here with vengeance, and he's going to turn the heat a little bit hotter. So, white horse. And where's this white horse coming from? Heaven. So I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him was called faithful and true. The other reason this can't be the Antichrist, not only because this horse is coming from heaven, is what? There is nothing faithful or true about the Antichrist. He's the unfaithful and untrue, right? There's nothing truthful about him. And so here he says, listen, I want you to know that Christ is coming, and I want you to know a character of Christ. Christ is faithful. What is faithful? Faithful is someone who is honest, someone who is true, and someone who does what with their promises? They keep them. He says, listen, I promised that this is going to happen, and so it is going to happen. You know what is something that people mock today that they're like, nah, it's not going to happen? You guys know what that is? Something that we Christians claim, and hopefully we believe it. Not just here, but we actually truly in our hearts believe it. You know what that is? The people mock. It's written about in Peter. The rapture, right? People are like, dude, that's funny. Everything is the same from back in those days till today. Everything is the same. It's not going to happen. Okay. The coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, born of a virgin, was that promised or not? Yes. Before the coming of Jesus or not? Before. And did it happen or not? Okay. The promise of the rapture. Was it promised or not? Yes. How long ago? Huh? So give me an idea, like roughly. Let's be very like rough estimate. Round to the nearest 1,000, huh? 2,000 years, right? 2,000 years. Is 2,000 years a long time to wait? Yes or no? Yes. So for people to mock it, say it's not going to happen because it hasn't happened for 2,000 years after it's been promised. Okay, we're rounding. It's pretty close. Do they have a right to kind of mock and say, that's funny? Yeah or no? Yeah. Okay, when Jesus was promised that he was going to be born, how long after that promise did he actually come? A while. I like the safe answer. 300 what? Years? No. 4,000 years. You know where's the first promise that Jesus is coming? Genesis chapter 3. The seed of the woman is going to wipe out the head of the serpent. Did it happen or not? 4,000. Is the Lord delayed in his promise right now? It's only been 2,000 years. hasn't even been 4,000, right? Now, I don't think we have 2,000 more years to go. Look at the times. Look at what's happening. Look at what Revelation says, the signs that are going to happen in the time of the tribulation. And the rapture happens after the tribulation. And the tribulation lasts 7 years. If things are set up right now, he's coming soon. He could come any day. Amen? So I hope we're ready for his coming. And I hope we don't numb ourselves from that. So Revelation 19, verse 11. Now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. First thing is, he's faithful. He's going to keep his promise. He's coming. And he is coming to beat up some people. I'll show you that in a second, because we just talked about, what did we talk about right now in verse 8 of 2 Thessalonians 2? That what's going to happen, we talked about the lawless one, he's going to be revealed, and then what's going to happen to him? Be consumed. So the Lord is going to what? Beat him up. Take care of him, right? So here's what we're talking about. Chapter 19, this is the end of the tribulation. Faithful and true. And he is true, he's honest, he never takes back his word, he never comes back on his word, and he never says something that is not the absolute truth. And not just that, and in righteousness he judges. He doesn't judge with emotions, doesn't judge with grudges, doesn't judge with any of that kind of stuff. But in righteousness, he judges. When he judges, it's fair. And it's the right amount at the right place to the right person in the right way and the right everything. So in righteousness, he judges and makes war. And because of that, he is here and he says, by the way, I'm coming on a white horse, and this is my war horse coming from heaven, and I am here to judge with righteousness, and I'm here to declare war. I'm here to declare war. Let's go to verse 15. Now, out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, or a two-edged sword. So here we see now what happened. What did we say in 2 Thessalonians? That his mouth, his breath, right? He's going to come and consume. And so here he says, tells us what happens with his mouth. When he opens his mouth, there's a sword that comes out. Okay? Not some spiritual thing or literal sword. Two-edged sword comes out. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations. And with that sword, he's going to go. He's declaring, he came, he declared war just a few verses ago. So he's going to what? He's going to actually use that sword to what? Not just declare war, but actually have war. He's going to strike the nations. And then what? And he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. Here he's talking about justice. He's here to take justice on this lawless world and the lawless one and what they have been doing. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. He's not here with grace anymore. He is here, wine press. He's talking about some anger, some wrath that he has on this world for rejecting him, for the world has done. And that's what he says here, that he shall strike the nations, and he himself, this is personal, he doesn't need anybody with him. You know, the angels are going to be with him. We're going to be with him. We're going to do nothing. He's going to do everything in this war. And this is what people call the War of Armageddon. And he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress. So here, he himself, he's really doing this. Winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. Now let's skip to verse 19. So here we saw from his mouth comes what? A sharp sword, or a two-edged sword. Verse 19. And I saw the beast. Okay, so here's the beast. And not just the beast, the kings of the earth. So here's the beast. And then he says he got backup. What's his backup? The kings of the earth. That's all. That's what he got. Everybody. He ganged up on who? On the Lord. And their armies. So not just the kings, but their armies. Gather together. What's his purpose? To make war against him who sat on the horse and against his army. So again, the person on the horse has to be the Lord, because he can't be fighting himself, right? So here he says, who sat on the horse and against his army. So here the Lord came declaring war, and the beast is like, so what? I'll declare war right back. I got kings, I got armies, and I got weapons. Now, I don't know if you've noticed, but throughout the generations and times, war has changed a bit, don't you think? Like, for example, if you go back to, like David's time, how did people, fight war? What'd they use? swords, huh? Bows, stuff like that, right? One time, this one king got really, like, talented. And so he created this machine thing that you put these big rocks in it and goes, whoop, and he started winning wars. This is in the Bible. So it's like, whoa, that's invention, man. It's like, whoop, getting, like, really high tech there. Now, how do people fight war? Huh? Nukes. Unless you're one of those little countries that doesn't have nukes. You got what? Guns, at least. Like, you're shooting at each other. Like, if Egypt tries to go to war, they don't have nukes. They got some guns, and hopefully they know how to use them, you know? We don't know how well they will do. And so I'm just making fun of our nation. So, you know, they're going to go do that. Now, he's got what? Everybody. So he's got nukes and whatever else will be ready in those days. He says, I got you. I'm going to press a button, and I'm going to blow you out the sky. But look at what happens. Then the beast was captured. Say what? He didn't have a chance to give a command to press nothing. He's like, are you kidding me? Like, under arrest. The beast is captured. So here's what, this is like the top leader of all these people, right? So the beast was captured. And with him, the false prophet. So he's like, hey, beast, you're the top guy in this world. Come over here. Captured him. And then he says, oh, by the way, who's the one that's like pumping you up and getting all these people to believe you? Oh, the false prophet? Okay, let me capture you too. And the false prophet. And with him, the false prophet who worked signs in his presence. And the false prophet's job is like, ooh, he does these miracles and things, which we'll talk about in a little bit. He does these miracles and all these things to make what people believe the beast and follow the beast and worship the beast and do all these things with the beast. False prophets and who did signs before him, so he arrested them, by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast. So that's what the prophets did. Is he deceived everybody. He made them get the mark of the beast, and those who worshipped his image, and then he had made people worship the image that he has made, an idol that he has made for him. These two were cast alive into the lake of fire, burning with brimstone. So they were taken, and where were they put? Yes, hell. Lake of fire with brimstone. What is that called? Hell. Are they alive or dead? Alive. Right? It says that, right? And these two were cast alive into the lake of fire burning with brimstone. If someone went to hell and died, that would be cool. Because they end. They vanish. There's no more suffering. But people go to hell and they are there forever alive. That's why if you know someone who's not a believer and you don't care or they get on your nerve and you don't, please, you don't want your worst enemy to go to hell and burn with fire forever. And if that gives you joy, please sit before the Lord and ask him if you're really saved. 2 Corinthians 13, test yourself, are you in the faith or not? Okay, please. So here they're cast into hell alive. But I don't know if you find this interesting or not. I find it really interesting. Because right now when someone dies, okay, say you're a believer and you die, where are you going? Heaven, right? Paradise, heaven, third heaven, whatever word you want to use. You're in heaven, you're in the presence of the Lord. Okay, let's say someone is an unbeliever and they die right now. Where are they going? Huh? Hades. Is that hell? No. They're in Hades. Where did these people go? These two? Hell. Did Satan go to hell at that time? Huh? Not yet. How long after that did Satan go to hell? 1,000 years later. And then after that, there was a great white throne. Then all the unbelievers came, and whose name is not written in the book of life, they were thrown into hell forever. These people angered the Lord so much He says, you two get to spend 1,000 extra years in hell more than anybody else, even Satan. That's crazy. That's how crazy these two will be. Lake of fire burning with brimstone, and the rest were killed with the sword, which proceeded from the mouth of him who sat on the horse. The rest of the people, all the nations and the leaders, all of them got killed by the sword that came out of his mouth. They were killed. And where did they go? Hades, not hell, not open yet. So Hades, and all the birds were filled with their flesh. And then there was a feast for all the type of birds that eat the bodies. And they enjoyed a nice meal that day. So here back to 2 Thessalonians, chapter 2, verse 8. And then the lawless one will be revealed. After the Holy Spirit is gone, and he's going to be gone because we're going to be raptured, because he dwells in us, so his main dwelling place is going to be in heaven. He's still not leaving earth, but that's not his main dwelling place, like we talked last week. Whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. And we've seen the breath of his mouth, and we've seen the brightness of his coming and what he did to the beast, to the false prophet, and to the people that came against him. Verse 9. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan. Now he says, okay, so I took a verse to give you the end result. The beginning, the lawless one comes out right after the Holy Spirit is taken out, and it comes out, it leaves, and then we saw his end, that the Lord is going to defeat him. He says, but now let me go back up and let me tell you how ugly this period is going to be. He says, listen, I want you to know how horrible and how powerful this guy is, that no one stands a chance against him. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan. He's fully empowered by Satan. He has all the authority, all the power, all the strength comes to him from Satan. He is Satan's masterpiece. Okay, so he came, and that's why no one can stand him. That's why he could do the things that he did. And he says, here's how Satan is going to back him up. With all power. So he's not going to give him some power, he's going to give him all power. And signs. And he's going to give him some signs. And not just that, and lying wonders. So Satan is a copycat. What Satan does is he likes to think, let me look at what the Lord does and copy it, because it must be effective. But I'm going to use it for my realm. So, for example, if you open up Acts chapter 2, verse 22, and here this is the day of Pentecost. This is Peter speaking after he talks about the prophecy of Joel. And he says here, he's preaching, and he says, men of Israel, this is after the Holy Spirit was given to the disciples and those who were gathered with them. Men of Israel, hear these words. Listen, guys, I want you to listen to this. What is it? Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus of Nazareth. What is he? A man attested by God to you. So here God proved him to you who he really is. And what did he use to give proof of him? He says, here's what he did. Miracles, wonders, and signs which God did through him in your midst, as you yourself also know. So God used what? Miracles, wonders, and signs. The Father used it with Jesus Christ. That's what Jesus Christ did. And because of that, he proved who he is. So Satan says, okay, then I'll do miracles, wonders, and signs to show my masterpiece, the beast, the Antichrist, to make him who he is. So Satan likes to copy. And not just that, Satan also saw through history, not only that this is what proved Jesus, but then he went to the most difficult state. Okay, you know what's the most difficult time to have people believe? When do you think that is? Times of peace, yes. But like time frame, like period of time. It's actually the time of the apostles. Why? We think it's hard today, and it's hard because there's a lot of lawlessness, but the hardness of then is what? Is that, did they have like a full Bible? No. Did they have like many translations, and it's gone out to many nations, and the word of God is very widespread? No. Did they have even something called being Christian as known? Like right now, if you say I'm Christian, anywhere in the world, be like, oh yeah, I think I know what that means. They might not like you, might have ideas about you, but they at least have an idea to even start a conversation and talk with you. In that time, there was really nothing. And so God had to use other methods to help them out. So, for example, in Hebrews, chapter 2, verse 1. Therefore, we must give the more earnest heed to the things we have heard, lest we drift away. For if the word spoken through angels proved steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord? And so here he's talking about, let's not ignore the word Lord's salvation. What he has done, it was spoken by the Lord, and was confirmed to us by those who heard him. So not only was it spoken by the Lord, and we've seen the word of God, but now it's been confirmed by what? Those who heard him. Who are those? The apostles. He says, how did they confirm this? God also bearing witness. So God used these things to bear witness with what? Signs and wonders, with various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit according to his own will. So as he saw was fitting, he used signs, wonders, miracles, and gifts of the Holy Spirit to prove that these people are apostles. So it's not the signs and wonders that saves people, but it says this is the apostles, this is the true word of God, and people start to accept. Even Paul himself in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12. Truly the signs of an apostle were accomplished among you with all perseverance. So he says, listen, I did signs among you. That's why I am the apostle. Because people think, who's the 12th one that replaces Judas? It's him. So he says, I've done it. It's signs, and here's how I did it. In signs and wonders and mighty deeds. Signs, wonders, and mighty deeds. Now, before we go further, can someone be a man of God and be called a man of God and not do any miracles or anything like that? Yes? No? Yes. Who? Tell me someone in the Bible that it says very clearly that this guy is a man of God, but also this guy has done no miracles. Danny. David. He's a man of God, and yes, he didn't do miracles, but can you show me where it said that about him? I like it, though. We're going to keep going through the list, huh? Moses, huh? Okay, how about, Good, how about New Testament? Huh? That's right. So that's when he went to his own city. He couldn't do miracles from how lack of faith they had. But Jesus did miracles, right? So I'm talking about someone who's never done a miracle. Epaphroditus, so you're right, but does it? But the mentioning of Epaphroditus is very little, and so we're getting warmer now. So not Mark, huh? No, huh? Peter raised the dead, man. What are you talking about? I mean, it doesn't get stronger miracle than that, huh? So that Onesimus. So but you're right. So but I want like so I'm asking. It's kind of ambiguous what I'm asking. I apologize. So I'm not. It's my fault. So it's someone that the Bible clearly says he is a man of God. So now we took out women. Okay, not that women are not people of God. I'm not gonna get in trouble after this. Okay, not a gender thing. Okay, talking about he says that he's a man of God, but also the Bible says he has done no miracles. Paul, people would, like, a handkerchief would touch him and then would go touch others and they would be healed. He did so many miracles. His first miracle, he made a man blind temporarily, huh? Barnabas, no. Okay, how about, I will just go into it. So, huh? John what? Yes. Good job. Let me prove it. John 1. The Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 6. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. So this man is from whom? From God. So we got that part taken care of, right? He's a man of God. Okay, let's go to John 10. Verse 41. Then many came to him and said, John performed no signs, but all the things that John spoke about this man were true. He's done no signs, but all these things were true. Why am I mentioning this? Well, so here's the thing. We've seen that Jesus did miracles, did signs, did wonders, and that was for a purpose, to prove that he's the Messiah. The apostles in those days, they did miracles, they did signs, they did wonders, and that was for a purpose, to prove that they are the apostles of Christ and to prove that the word that they are sharing is truth. Paul the Apostle did signs, wonders, and miracles because he is an apostle, and that was a critical thing for when you strictly define apostle. There's a loose definition of apostle today. That is not what we're talking about. We're talking about the strict definition of apostle, only 12. And that one part of it, you had to do miracles, signs, and wonders. So every one of the 12 has done that. But the thing is, sometimes we become overtaken by that thought, by that idea that we just look for it. Now, I just want to be clear. Does God do signs, wonders, and miracles today? Yes, he does. He does it all the time. But when he does it for a reason, for a purpose. And he does it to fulfill something that is in his eyes. But what sometimes where we get caught up is we are looking for that sign. And we give signs and we look for it. We're looking for a wonder. We're looking for things. And this sometimes overtakes us enough that it veers us away from the word of God and the truth of God. But the thing is, what we should all strive to be is to, I want to be a person of God, a man of God, a woman of God, in the way that you want me, Lord, whether I never perform a sign, a miracle, or wonder, or whether you allow me to be able to do that, or whether you allow me to witness that. That is just a cherry on top. That's just a frosting. That's something that's just so enjoyable that I get to enjoy from you. But that is not, I'm not here to look at that. I'm here to look at you and focus on you. So now, can Satan do signs, wonders, and miracles or not? Yes. So 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan. So the one who's empowering him, the one doing all the work in him is Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders. So he does it with all power, signs, and lying wonders. Does he do real wonders or not? Lying wonders, true wonders or not? Huh? So is it an illusion? Is he an illusionist? Right? So what you would call a wonder that is fake is what is an illusion. So right. So it is a real, that's where I want to go with this. It will be. And I'll show you, hopefully if we have time, I'm going to have to rush really fast because I want to take you through a couple of things in Revelation. He has absolute authority, the ability to do signs, wonders, but the purpose of it is to deceive people. When the Lord does signs and wonders, it proves who he is. If Satan was to do the exact signs and wonders, it would be detrimental to the kingdom of Satan. That's why he would never copy him in that. He just copies the idea, but he can't copy the exact thing. Now, can Satan copy God or not? In his, like, say, God does a sign or a miracle, and he's like, boom, I'm going to give you the same exact thing or not. Can he do it or not? Yeah? Can you prove it? Has he ever done it? Huh? Moses, he did it with all of them or no? He did all 10 of them? No, he can't do all 10 because, you know, some of them, you know, they said that this is, one of them is really amazing. So they went and then Pharaoh got really like pumped up. He's like, so what? Even though it's hurting him, he's really dumb, you know? He's like, God does something and it hurts just the Israelites. I mean, just the Egyptians. It doesn't do anything to the Israelites. And then he's like, can y'all do this? They said, yeah. So they do it. And so they hurt the Egyptian now more, right? And nothing happens. Like, he's like, oh, it's okay. I got someone that could do it. So then one of them, they do. God does something through Moses and Aaron. And then they try to do it and they can't. He's like, come on, guys. And they're like, no, this is, they don't even say this is the hand of God. They say this is the finger of God. He's so powerful that, you know, from how powerful we see him, you know, the hand is like requires a lot of power. This is so easy for him. It's just his finger. And we can't even copy. We can't come close. There's limits to what we are able to do. I was going to show you some of those verses, but I don't have time. Can people, so we've seen in the Old Testament that people can do signs and wonders that copy exactly what God's signs and wonders are, right? Do we agree or not? Yes or no? Hopefully we agree. Okay. And the proof is, read Exodus 7 and 8. You'll see it in the 10 plagues. How about in the New Testament? Can people do actual signs and wonders? Yes. And it is real, but it is deception. Yes. Does anyone know one of the disciples who went to hell? Or he's going to go to hell, but he's in Hades right now? Judas. Did Judas do any signs, wonders, and miracles? They all did, yeah. He did it. And then Jesus stands the last day, and he sits before the people, and he says, hey, you guys. They said to him, hey, our claim that you should let us in. They said, we've done miracles, we've done signs, we've done it in your name. He says, get away from me. I don't know. And they've actually done it. So may the Lord help us to know that not because there's a sign or there's a wonder that we need to what? Just believe and follow that. Because even if it's under his name, under a Christian name, we have to be very careful. I'm going to show you one more thing before I go to Revelation because I was hoping to show you more of these things. But just Deuteronomy chapter 13, a few verses there. Just plainly God says it. Deuteronomy 13 verse 1. If there arises among you a prophet, so who's speaking? Moses, speaking, you know, obviously the Holy Spirit is guiding him to write this. So he says, if there arises among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams. And so here, who is this? A prophet or a dreamer of dreams. And he says, oh, by the way, I'm not just that. And he gives you a sign or a wonder. So what are we talking about? Signs and wonders. He actually does it. He's like, boom, sign and wonder. Well, he tells you about it. He's going to do it. And then he doesn't just tell you about it, and the sign or the wonder comes to pass. It actually happens right before your eyes. Not an illusion, a real thing that happens. Of which he spoke to you, saying, let us go after other gods, which you have not known, and let us serve them. So here he does the sign, he does the wonder, and it actually happens right before your eyes, and it's the sign that he actually told you that he's going to do. So it's not like, be like, who says it's going to be fire, and it turned out to be ice. And he just like misfired. And actually, exactly what he said exactly happens, right? He says, but his message is, let's go after another god that you don't know, or let's serve this other god. And what shall you do? He says, yes, you've seen a wonder. You've seen a sign happen right before your eyes, and it's real. It's not an illusion. Here's what I would expect of you, the Lord says. You shall not listen to the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams. Don't listen. For why? For the Lord your God is testing you to know whether you love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. He's testing you. Are you going to follow him from all your heart, from all your soul, because you know his commandment, you know what he says, and this is against the commandment. Doesn't matter how wowing and how real that miracle and sign is. You say, in your face, get out. I will not follow you because you are against his commandment. I love the Lord. I don't love you. I love God and I follow God. I will not follow a deceiver, even if you come with power and might and you're able to do something right before my eyes. You shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice. You shall serve him and hold fast to him. Hold fast to the Lord. Know the Lord. Know the word of the Lord and obey the word of God always. But that prophet or that dreamer of dreams shall be put to death, because he has spoken in order to turn you away from the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of bondage, to entice you from the way in which the Lord your God commanded you to walk. So you shall put away the evil from your midst. I want you with that guy to be very harsh, to have, that's it, no relationship. And in their days, to put this person to death. We need what will protect us. And that's what, back to 2 Thessalonians, chapter 2 and verse 2, not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, even if it comes in the form of spirit. And they said, the Spirit told Paul this. He says, lie. Or by word, people said, I heard Paul say this. Lie, because you know the word of God. Or by letter, as if it from us. Lie, even if it's signed exactly in my name, you know that this is not true. Why? Verse 5, do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? Go back to the word. Go back to the roots. You will not be shaken. You will not be confused by whatever form of lie, deception comes your way. But you need to know the word in order to be able to defend yourself. You know, there's a sword that comes out in the word of God in the Ephesians chapter 6. You guys know that what the sword is a symbol of? Huh? The word of God. And you know, in the armor, the full armor of God of Ephesians chapter 6, there is which part of the body, you know that it's all covered, right? Except one part. You know what part is not covered? The back. Why? You should never run away from the enemy. Okay, how many defensive parts and how many offensive parts? Okay, let's make it easy. How many offensive parts do you have? One. Everything else is what? Defensive. What's the offensive? The sword. Your only way to not turn around and be vulnerable, because your back is not covered with anything, is to go with the offensive. What is it? The word of God. I cannot use the word of God if I don't know the word of God. That's why Paul tells them, I believe in Colossians, he says, you guys are so carried away by every wind of doctrine. Whatever's flowing, whatever's the season of today, you all fall for it. What's wrong with you? To the Galatians, he says, you foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? That you turn so quickly away from the gospel of truth? Are you kidding me? Guys, we need to know the word of God so that we can recognize these things. Not every sign, not every wonder is from God. They may be absolutely true and real, but it may be for a purpose of deception. I'm just going to end with Revelation just to show what's going to happen in those days. Revelation 13, a couple of verses from that chapter. Revelation 13, then I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name. So here you see a beast. There's two beasts. This is the beast that's coming out of where? The sea. So he's a beast, it's a Gentile. And here, this, if you look at this and you compare it with Daniel, the conclusion to come with is that he's talking about a nation, multiple nations that are going to come together and rise up with power in Europe. And he's going to come and have that ability. So I don't have time. I'm going to try to rush through this for a purpose about the signs and wonders. Now, the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. So here we see descriptions, and this, if you want to understand it, you have to go back to Daniel and look at the vision of Daniel and be like, oh, that makes sense. And then you're going to find that these are talking about nations that were in Daniel's time, and that they're going to be resurrecting, and he's one of them resurrecting with them. And so here he says that the dragon gave him his power. So who gave him his power? The dragon. You guys know who the dragon is? Satan. You know who this beast is? The Antichrist. The guy in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. So you have the Antichrist empowered by who? Satan. Is it pretty clear in Revelation 13 or no? Yes. Okay? Don't leave that, because 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9, it says, the coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan. Do they match up or no? Absolutely, right? So here we see the Antichrist empowered the working of Satan, and we see here that the dragon empowers him, right? So back to Revelation chapter 13, verse 2. Now the beast, verse 3, and I saw, verse 2. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, not just his power, but also his throne. He became the leader of all these nations, and great authority. And that's why he can claim to be God. Verse 3, something happened to him. And I saw one of his heads, as if it had been mortally wounded. So one of the heads is what? What's mortally? Huh? Pierced by a sword, yes. So if you mortally wounded, how am I looking? Huh? Fatal wound, so what am I like? I'm dead. Thanks for being so fast at that one, huh? And I saw one of his heads as it had been mortally wounded. So, dead. And his deadly wound was healed. But what happened? It's healed. That's crazy. And all the world marveled and followed the beast like, whoa. So people differ a little bit at what this means, the head and... So I'll give you my opinion. He literally, and this to me makes sense, he literally died. And then Satan, the dragon, gave him life, obviously taking permission from God. So, and as we're going to see in 2 Thessalonians, that he allowed them to have deception and things like that. So here we see, God is allowing them to have deception, because it's the end times. He's ready to end this thing. So he allowed him to come to life. That is the only thing that would make someone literally marvel and follow somebody. Be like, you must be so powerful if you completely died and you resurrected. Marveled and followed the beast. So what did they do? Not only that, they're like, you must be God. So they worshipped the dragon. So who's that? Satan, who gave authority to the beast, and they worshipped the beast. And guess who's going to sit in the temple as God, claiming to be God? The Antichrist. Who's what? The beast. Crazy. Saying, who is like the beast? Fatally wounded, and now completely healed, as if nothing happened. Who is able to make war with him? Who can stand against him? The answer is nobody, except God, of course, which happens in chapter 19 that we already looked at. No one can stand a chance against this beast. Now, let's go from verse 11, okay? And I'm going to end because I want you to see this. There's another beast. Okay, this thing is not done. Then I saw another beast coming up out of the earth. Where is this beast coming from? The earth. Is that the same the beast as the other one or different? Different. So this out of the earth, this is symbolic of someone who is a Jew. A beast coming out of the earth. And so here we see what we said Satan likes to do what when it comes to God? He likes to what? Copy him. So we've seen when it comes, it's like he says, the Lord proved himself and the apostles proved themselves by signs, wonders, and miracles. So he says, well, I'm going to do the same thing. And he did it with the beast. Well, what's something about God that we know about him? He is one, but he's also what? Trinity. So he says, I'll be Trinity too. I got beast out of the sea, beast out of the earth, and dragon. So I'm going to try to copy God, and let's see how we do this. So here he comes, and then I saw another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns, like a lamb, and spoke like a dragon. This one is different, right? The other one, we talked about different numbers of horns and heads and things. He says, no, no, no. He has two horns, and these two horns are what? Like a lamb. Anyone here scared of a lamb? If you are, you got some problems. They're just, they don't do anything. They're not scary. He says, I'm just a little peaceful guy. This one is who? This is not the Antichrist. This is the false prophet. And he's Jewish. That's how he's going to deceive the Jewish nation. Because the Jewish nation is not going to allow anybody to. This guy has to pump them up. Peaceful. And not just that, but he's going to what? He's going to speak. He spoke like what? A dragon. But his words, demonic. But looks cute. Looks peaceful. And he exercises all the authority of the first beast in his presence. He's just as powerful as the first beast, and he does it in front of the other one. He is blessed by the other beast, and he's empowered by the other beast. And not just that, and causes the earth and those who dwell in it to worship the first beast. The false prophet says, hey, you guys, look at me. I'm powerful and all these things. So he was able to get everybody, and including the Jews, to say, okay, go worship this guy. Go worship the beast, this Gentile guy. Go worship him. Whose deadly wound was healed. And he's, look at him. The dragon gave him life. You need to worship this guy. And then he, what does he do, this false prophet? He performs great signs. What does he do? Great signs. So that he even makes fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. A real miracle happens in front of people. And what does he do? He's copying. He doesn't like those two witnesses. You guys know about those two witnesses? There's these two witnesses from God, and fire would come down. He's like, okay, well, I could do the same thing. It's like two witnesses, boom. So he does fire, comes down from heaven. And he deceives those who dwell on the earth by those signs. He uses them what? For deception. Which he was granted to do in the sight of the beast. And this was, power was given to him. Again, by the dragon, he speaks like a dragon, and he does it in the sight of the beast, and he's pointing all the power to the beast, telling those who dwell on the earth to make an image to the beast who was wounded by the sword and lived. He says, okay, let's make, this guy was, he was wounded. There was a real sword that came and killed him, and now he's alive, so I want you to make an image. What is an image? An idol. I want you to make an idol to the beast. And then he does something. He was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast. So an idol, okay, we're not talking illusions, we're talking real power here. We're not talking TV, we're talking an idol in front of you, no mechanics inside of it, and now it has breath. This guy is powerful. Not just breath. And the image of the beast should both speak, and it speaks. Not remote controlled. Not programmed, not Siri, you know, has multiple things been recorded. No. Like real language in real time and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. It recognizes who's not worshiping it and kills them. You know what's crazy is the idol is going to go into the temple of God. It's like, he's like total blasphemy. He's like, in your face, you don't want idols? I'm going to put an idol right in your temple. In your face, God. Anyone who worships you, I will not allow them to do that. But here we've seen he's done miracles, he's done signs, he's done wonders. I mean, if he can give life to an idol, you know, it's a lot easier to give life to something dead that was really alive before, the first beast. Back to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 8. And then the lawless one will be revealed. He says, don't be scared of him. Why? Whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. The victory is the Lord's. We're going to be in heaven, and this is going to be just a show for us. Until, obviously, that day we're going to come with the Lord. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan. He's demonically empowered with all power, signs, and lying wonders. Satan can copy the Lord and can do the real thing that the Lord does. He has that ability. I pray that we don't get deceived by why it comes our way and how nice it looks, but that we come to know the Lord and say, Lord, I want to know your word. I want to know you. I want to follow you. I want to do what it is that you want me to do to glorify you all the time, period. I want to be for your glory. But Lord, knowing these facts should not scare me, but should excite me as a believer, because your coming is soon. And should excite me as a believer because I'm going to get to see you, but should also put passion and zeal within me for people who are lost, that I can't just let them go their way, but I have to try to find a way to share with them, to give them the love of Christ in whatever method, in whatever way, but I can't just keep silent. Let's spend a couple of minutes in prayer, and if anyone wants to pray out loud, let him pray.